The date is June the 11th, 2010. Today we're doing a living history with Charles Harper, one of the original members of the Heritage Society and one of the founding members of the Wichita County Heritage Society. I'm Ellen Yonke, and the interview is being done at the Kell House Carriage House. Charles Harper, first would you give us, please, your full name, your date of birth, and your educational and professional background?
My full name is Charles Floyd Harper, Jr. Of course, Charles Floyd Harper, Sr. has been dead a long time, and I don't go by that anymore. Most people don't know that, but at any rate, I'm a junior. Very proud to have my father's name, by the way. And I was born in Longham, Texas, which is east of here. And November the 15th, 1929, 2 weeks after the stock market crash in 1929, always told a story. My father always told the story that I caught. And I always say, come back and said that, you know, no, I was 2 weeks after, not before. So at any rate, I grew up in Bonn. My family has lived there for well over 100 years, one part of it. And so we're old fixtures there, and I'm the only one that ever escaped that lives anywhere other than Panama County. I decided I wanted to be an architect when I was about 7 years old. My father was a farmer when I was born, and like so many people, he was driven off the farm, lost his farm and everything else when the Depression started. And he went to work for the National Youth Administration in North Texas, and, which was a government agency that taught young men to do construction work. My dad took me out on the job with him. They did everything, and they were doing a building there in Bonn, and they had some stone on it, so they had to go and cut the stone and bring it in and out. And so Dad took me out to the stone quarry with him, and while we were out there, a man came up in a big black T model. It was a big car. I thought it was the biggest car I'd ever seen in my life. Remember, I was 7 years old. They would put it about 1935, somewhere along there. And he was dressed up in a black suit and had a black hat, and he was tall. And my dad was a big man, and he was a 6'4", and weighed 250 pounds. And so I could tell what little bit I was around it that he was telling my dad what to do. And so when it was over, I asked my dad, who was that man? He said, that was the architect on the project. And so I asked him what an architect was, and he told me from a contractor's point of view. And I decided, that's what I want to do. Anybody can tell my dad what to do, that's what I want to do. So I set out at that time to become an architect. In high school, they used to have drawing classes and things like that in high school, but they don't seem to have much anymore. And I took all those and did real well in it. My sisters had some art ability, and later on in their lives were pretty well known around North Texas for their art sketch work and stuff like that. So I decided I wanted to be an architect and I wanted to go to school. When I graduated from high school in 1948, just before the Berlin blockade had started, and of course we'd all been through World War II, and I'd grown up thinking that someday I'd love to be a Marine, because there's got all the things that all the big history and the information was given out about them, and they were the heroes of World War II. So I decided and they put out a thing I haven't heard of it since, but if you were 18 and a high school graduate, you could join any of the services for 2 years instead of 4 years, which was the normal time. So I thought, well, I believe I'll go get into that and get that over with so I won't have this. But we all thought World War III was about ready to start with Russia, with the Soviet Union. So I went to the Marine Corps. They said, yes, we can take it. I took the test, and I made a flying color, a grade on it. They took it. They wanted me, and they said, we can take you. We can get you at boot camp in November. No, don't want to go in November. Want to go now because I want to get out in the summertime so I can go to school when I get out 2 years from now. So I went to the Navy and the Navy said the same thing, they'd get me in boot camp in November. No. So I went, so I go to the Army and find out. I really didn't want to go to the Army, but I had a love for airplanes. My dad, from my dad, who took me out to the airport there in Tacoma. And we watched the airplanes take off and fly. And so said, can't you get me in the Air Corps? He said, you're in luck. The Air Corps is just getting ready to turn into the Air Force. And you can join the now, you can join the Air Corps and then become part of the Air Force when the time comes in September of that year. So the next, he said, can I go? And he says, in the morning. But be at the Union Station in Dallas at 8 o'clock in the morning, and you're on your way to Blackman Air Force Base to be a member of the United States Air Corps. So I took off and did that. About halfway through my basic training, which was 90 days at the time, long in the first part of about the middle of August or thereabouts, they woke us up one morning and said, we want everybody to, all the whole flight, the basic flight, to get all your belongings, put them in a double bag, we're moving. Where are we moving? Well, we're moving to Wichita Falls, Texas, to reopen Shepherd Air Force Base up there. So we came overnight on a train that night to Wichita Falls and got out on Shepherd. And it hadn't been open in 4 or 5 years, about 3 or 4 years. And it was waist deep in grass, tumbleweeds, and dirty and filthy, and you can't imagine what it was. We were the first people that I think had been on the site since it had closed in 45. So we worked and cleaned that up for a while, and then I graduated, and I had made a pretty good grade on my test, so they sent me to, I was sent to be a part of a flying school. I mean, a flying unit in Carville Air Force Base at Fort Worth. Thought that was great then. I wish now they'd been somewhere else where I could have gotten all the way from home. But it was close to home. And I was made a part of a B-36 flying squadron. And so I served in that for 2 years. And while I was in, I decided I would better decide where I'm going to go to school. If this gets too long, I mean, couldn't it? But I wrote off to 75. I went down to the library in Bonn and got the address of every college that I could find that had an architecture school. So I wrote off to 75 different schools. I thought I'd never get that done. And asked them for a catalog. And I got that back and I spent about 3 months going through those trying to see which courses looked like the one I wanted to take. So I finally narrowed it down to two schools. Cornell in New York State and Texas Tech in Texas. They had just what I wanted, the course I wanted to take and wanted to go to. So I thought, well, I really wanted to go to Cornell because it had exactly what I wanted. So at any rate, to make a real long story short, I wrote off to the two schools, and I could go to Tech for 5 years, so I got one semester at Cornell. So that sort of set that up, so I went off to Texas Tech. I married my wife, Betsy, that's from Lubbock, lived in Lubbock. She was born up in the border of Manhattan. She lived in Lubbock, and we then decided when we got married that we were going to live. I didn't get a job back here. We liked Wichita Falls. It was sort of close to where I lived. And so we moved here. Then that firm went under. We moved back to Lubbock for 4 years while her mother battled breast cancer. And then we came back here in 1961. The firm that I came back to work for, I got tired of working for and opened my own firm in 1962, in September. 1962. From that, stayed here with the idea, I didn't know what I was gonna do for a while. But it turned out real well. We got work, we had some work, and work came our way, and we were successful with a partner that I had with one of the people from the old firm. Was able to get some work at the rehab model in addition to Bethania Hospital, and very quickly became the architect for Bethania Hospital. And that was quite a bit of work. The biggest job that we ever did was in addition to that. We did well, and then in the late 60s, I was elected as vice president, while I was vice president of the Texas Society of Architects, which is the AIA regional organization of the American Institute of Architects, AIA, people are familiar with. And there was two disasters hit two cities in Texas. Lubbock had a tornado in the spring of 1970, and Hurricane Celia hit Corpus Christi in the fall of 1970, and both of them were very bad disasters, tore the town pretty bad. The architects of those two cities asked the president of TSA, at that time was an architect of Fort Worth, if there wasn't something that we couldn't, the architects of the state helped them out, they just needed help to get the city going back together. So it was Preston Gary, who was the president. He called me and said, "Charlie, I got a job for you. I want you to go to Lubbock and Corpus Christi and find out what on earth we can do to help them. Get a committee together if you want to, and you want to take on all the seats." So I did. That was the start of my work in disaster. I wrote a book about what architects can do in disaster, and really still used by the Texas Society of Architects. A couple of years later, I asked me to do the same thing nationally, and from that time until 5 years ago, I was chairman of the National AIA's Disaster Response Committee, and wrote a lot of books for it. Went back when nobody was doing anything about it, and it became well known worldwide, not just nationwide, for response to natural disasters. I spent a lot of time doing that and did a lot of innovating things, found out a lot of things about tornadoes and windstorms. My friends at Texas Tech that I went to school with, I also have a degree that I can be a civil engineer. And so I took a lot of engineering while I was in school. And my engineer classmates started the Wind Institute at Lubbock. So, We got all that started, and that's gone on to be a big thing in the country. We rewrote the book on tornadoes after the so-called tornado. That was kind of where we learned a lot of things. I got them to come here and spend 3 months doing a lot of study. During that time of 78 and 79, we had already started working preservation in Wichita Falls in about 1970, and I'm sorry, I don't remember the exact time, but Ken Hendrickson and I, you want to go into this now?
Yes, go ahead.
Dr. Ken Hendrickson at Midwestern, and was a good friend, and I had, he had talked me into helping support his history department out there, and we gave him a pretty good chunk of money each year for help them with tuition for students. And we became real good friends, and we talked about the preservation in Wichita Falls, but we couldn't see that there was anything going. They tore down the depot, the old depot, which was really a jewel. It was the city had fallen in on a local TV personality, and so the Burlington Railroad said, "Well, we'll just tear it down." The editor and publisher of the newspaper was on the board of the Burlington, and I spent quite a bit of time trying to talk to him, to talk him out of it, sitting in his office for a whole day one time. And finally, just, you know, I could see him in his office, and find out he's got up and walked in, so kind of hacked him off. You know, I used to laugh about it later on when we became friends, but he wouldn't do it, said he couldn't. He wasn't going to do it. That old village didn't torn tearing down, and he was all for it. He was going to get it, and I tried every way I could to talk him out of it, but he didn't, and it was torn down. At about the same time, they started redoing the courthouse, and as I remember, one of the commissioners was in my church, and I talked to him, and he told me, well, come down and talk to the commissioner's court. So I did. This was before they'd done anything. Tried to talk about doing that, and there it was. He said, well, nobody likes this old village anymore. We need to cover this up and make it modern and new. And of course, that was the thing. Yeah, that was the same year that they did what they did to the Big Blue Bank downtown, which was also a beautiful old building. And they covered it up with a metal or something now. A year or two later, they put the stucco on the Staley building and ruined it. So we needed to do something to bring attention to the people in the city that we have some really architectural jewels in our city that needed to be preserved and kept available to be used by the people and enjoyed by the people. That conversation with Ken Henderson led to talking to other people that I've always thought that they also helped him out some way with that. So, but at any rate, we got with some other people that we thought might be interested, and we met out in my office down on the old Jacob Highway, and over about a year put together the starting of the Wichita County Heritage Society. We had a big battle at first about whether it was going to be the Wichita Falls Heritage Society or the Wichita County Heritage Society. And a couple of us were pushing to make it bigger than just the city, because there are other buildings and other parts of the county that need help. So we made it a county. And I think that was the right thing to do. I think it's taken off out at the Electra, Iowa Park, and Burford End, like we thought it might. It is there, and I know that I would work with the city of Electra on the Grand Theater over there. I know that you all have been involved in helping with that. So I think that was the right thing to do. We put together the rules. Somebody on the board, there was some, the luckiest part that we did was we got some young women in town that had grown up here that were really go-getters, and they took into it real quickly and got things going and got some other people. And the idea at first, we thought, well, we can't do anything if we don't have some kind of funding that like dues or something, and we don't want to make the dues too high, so we need to pretty good size membership. And so we started talking to the older people in town that had grown up and lived here, the people that were getting to the age of retirement at the time, a lot of them. They joined. They thought it was a great idea, and we were very pleased. And not only did we have dues, but we had some very nice gifts from those people and dollar amounts to help us out and to get started. We met all over town at first, and we met one of the best places that we met was the second floor of the old Wicks Mansion, when it was used to be a restaurant that day. And we met there for several years and kept things going before we moved around some other places. We decided that one of the things that we wanted the way we could keep it going the way we wanted it to go was to make the rule in there that I think there were six of them, named as original directors, and that we were members for life. Probably wasn't the best thing in the world to do, but that's how, that was the way we were gonna keep it working. Well, it turned out that it worked a lot better than we ever dreamed it would. And probably that probably needs to be taken out somewhere. I'm not sure it can be the way you set it up, but we'll all pass on one of these days. You don't have to worry about this anymore. I think about two or three of us already anyway. But, ladies that joined us were, as I said, were really go-getters, and they started doing all sorts of things. One of the things that we talked about way back in the early parts of it was that if we could set up a house museum of some sort, and this sort of gets over into the Kell House acquisition. So we talked about that, and we got to know the people that were involved, and the last sister was still alive and lived here, and we actually, Mr. O'Donnell, I never did know exactly what how kin he was, but he's a cousin or something of the Kells. You all probably know, and I've forgotten how he's kin, but he was still alive and very, very interested in our Heritage Society. And he got us an invitation to come and tour the house I can't remember her name now.
Would that have been Willie Mae?
Willie Mae, yeah, Willie Mae. was still alive. She was very old at the time. And so we came over, toured it, met her, talked with her, very gracious lady. And the house was like stepping back into 1920 when we walked in and into the furnishings and looks and everything kind of left like it was when the Kells got their furnished for probably the last time in their life. And it hadn't had much done to it on the inside. It was very old. The furniture was very old, but it was a great old furniture. We started talking about with O'Donnell about somewhere down the line of having a chance to acquire the house as property of the Heritage Society. He thought that was a great idea and said, I'll talk to Willie Mae about it. And that took off real good. And I'm not sure what all happened in between there, but I got off and got involved in the tornado recovery and all that kind of stuff here in town. City politics and kind of lost out on what was happening with the house. But all of a sudden, Ken called me one day and says, we got it. And we got the price. But it wasn't very much compared to what we thought it'd be. So we raised the money for that and acquired the property. And then the thing was, what are we going to do with it? We got it, you know. So, at any rate, that didn't take long to figure out, because by that time we'd gotten a lot of the older, long-term people that lived in what's called and become members of the Heritage Society. And they sort of helped us along with that at first. And then you all probably are familiar with the rest of the story there. Came on to us today. It's a great thing that we have here in town that people come to see, and we hope that it stays where it is. So, I remember the 4th of July picnics we used to have a long time ago on the yard, and I guess still have them. I heard that we don't have it this year, but
we're having it.
We are, okay. But that was always a lot of fun to have little kids and their bikes and all that kind of thing here. And Merle Anthony making the speech, that was sort of the way it was for the 4th of July. But that's kind of how I got into it. My professional part of my life, we got a lot of work here, and I ended up with being registered architect. To be an architect and do work in the state, you have to be registered in that state. I got a national license, which makes it easier to get registered. And ended up being registered in 11 states, from Arizona across the southern tier of states to North Carolina and Florida. We did a lot of work for White's Auto Stores, for Earl White and the people that owned that. Clear up to the time that they did. We did White's Auto Stores all of the south. And we did a lot of banks all over Texas, Oklahoma, Louisiana. Not Louisiana, I'm sorry. That's the only state I wasn't registered in, and anything. That's another story. I feel like you'd like to hear it, but it doesn't have anything to do with some of them. My professional life has been pretty good. We had the tornado that happened here in 79. We were in the edge of it. We got some damage in our house out on Amherst and Southwest Parkway. We got a fourth or so of the roof torn up. Some windows broken, several trees blown down, and all the inches around the yard was blown down. Most of the damage was north of Southwest Parkway at that area, and behind the across the street from our house is a large Episcopal church that's in there. Most of the damage was behind them. The church roof was torn up quite a bit. I was out of town when the tornado hit, and Dalton was talking to a church in Sesoto. And they left here about 3 o'clock. And when I got through about a little bit at 5, and somebody came in about 6 and said, "I thought you'd be home." I said, "Why?" He said, "Well, Wichita Falls just got hit by a tornado." And I thought, well, I knew that Vernon had been hit, so I know, well, these people down here don't know the difference between Vernon and Wichita Falls. So I got in my car and started home and stopped to get gas. And I got to thinking, you know, maybe he was right. So I turned on the radio in Dallas and picked up KRLC, one of the local stations there in Dallas, and they were talking to somebody on a ham operator on the telephone in San Antonio that had talked to somebody on a ham operator with a phone, and they described the tornado that hit the city. Now, you've got to know that my office is on the old Dexter Highway. I live on Amherst and Southwest Parkway. So the description was that a massive tornado had hit the city of Wichita Falls at a football stadium in the southwest part of town. Look where that was. Came down a street called Southwest Parkway, destroyed that street down until it got to the Jack Murray Highway, and then turned into the downtown area. I had 15 employees, and they all lived in that close to that area. So I started home as fast as I could get home, but too fast. Got stopped twice by highway patrol. Both times they let me go. One time they got me through Decatur in a hurry so I could get on outside. I was passed by several vans coming to Wichita Falls and were going faster than I was. They were going after loot. So I got into Wichita Falls, there was no power. Finally got down Southwest Parkway. Well, I went by my office and saw that it was still standing, but all the buildings around it weren't, but it was. And went on to my home down Southwest Parkway. When I passed by Southwest Parkway, by where I lived, pulled into Amherst, I noticed that the benches were down, there wasn't a light down. And I drove in the driveway, and my wife's car was not there. She had a Blazer. Remember the Blazer that they used to have, which was a four-wheel drive vehicle that she had. But my son's car, my youngest son, who still lived at home with us, he had just graduated from high school, was there. My heart fell out, and I went in, and when I did the lights flashed on the front, and out came my wife and my oldest son and his wife. They'd lost their apartment. He'd just getting ready to graduate from Midwestern. And, but Mark, our youngest son, was not there. So I asked for Mark. Betsy said, my wife said he had, has my car, he's out looking for it. Or his girlfriend, who's kind of his fiance. And they hadn't really made any big announcement, but they've been going together for a while. We sat there and watched the, everything that happened. And I won't go into that, but that's another big story. But we had a lot of things happen. The next morning, we went to bed finally about midnight. Felt like we could. We had chased people out of our backyard and tried to put them on their house. I had a shotgun, hunting shotgun, and I went out in the backyard and had my wife shine a flashlight on my back. And I told her just get back in their van and back out. They had driven up on into their backyard and leave. I had a shotgun. They started coming on, so I just fired the shotgun over their head. They left in a hurry and were gone. About that time, the helicopters came over and put all the lights down and everything. We went to bed about 5 o'clock in the morning while the lights came on in our house. And, we got up and decided that we'd better get up and get dressed and do whatever it is we want to do. We didn't have any water. We had some, Betsy had filled up the bathtub and we had enough and we thought we'd flush the boat or whatever might happen. So I decided, well, I'll go out and get the paper and see what happened. Not ever dreaming, you know, I didn't think that there was no power, there wouldn't be any paper. So I went out in the front yard and there was a police car sitting in our driveway. We have a circular drive. And I noticed that there was a policeman and he was nodding off. Then I recognized him as the chief of police, Kurt Carroll. He was a good friend of mine. We both flew about Kickapoo, our planes out of Kickapoo. We'd known each other real well over there. And woke him up and I said, Curtis, what are you doing out here in my driveway? And he says, the mayor, who was Kenneth Hill, has called a special emergency meeting of the council at 8 o'clock down to the city hall. City Hall, okay. I heard that the downtown got hit and all the downtown didn't get hit. Too much trade on out and didn't go downtown. Said that we know last time I had gotten a pretty good reputation about knowing about disasters. No, you know about disasters and we want to talk to you about that. We don't know anything about disasters. So they asked me what I thought they would do and I told them that they needed a committee to put it all together, the people that we could put together. Well, so, I got the name to chairman of the committee to put it all back together. And that's when I really learned about disasters, about parts of it that I hadn't even thought about before.
Well, tell us, if you would, please, we'd like your opinion on which are the most endangered buildings, locations, structures in Wichita Falls that, if someone had bottomless pockets, what should we be looking at and in what kind of an order? Do you have any thoughts on that?
Yes, I do. The empty buildings that are downtown, most of which were done by the architect builder, Aurora, back in the 20s and 30s, when it was so bold really around, and they're empty now. Most of them are empty. Well done buildings, really great buildings. They're probably the most endangered building around. They are all over downtown here.
Buildings by O'Rourke.
O'Rourke.
Now, does this tie in, or could you tell us, you mentioned to me privately a photography project that you had done that ties in with your architecture. Could you just briefly tell us about that?
In 1975, I hired a young intern architect from Texas Tech to work for us, who was from here, Jimmy Armstrong, who is an ancestor of the Armstrong family, which was part of the White's auto story. His mother was a White, Marilyn Armstrong. You probably know her, but, well, you don't. she was a wife of the White Auto Store. And Jimmy worked for us that summer. And I asked him to, I told him what I wanted to do. I wanted to go around. We drove around the city, downtown area, and said, here are the buildings that I want you to take, and any others that you might see while you're doing it. We want to take pictures. We want to record these pictures.
We're talking about your project with Jamie Onstadt. Stop.
I got him and brought him a new camera, a new 35mm camera. I wanted him to take slides. Excuse me. I wanted him to take slides of all these buildings. And what I wanted him to do was to take a picture of the front of the building and all the exterior side that was open, and take a picture that was back far enough that you could see what was around the building, what buildings were around it, if any. And then come in and start taking pictures of details and things on the building, like the front entrance and windows and a lot of other things, kind of like on the old Hamilton building. Most people don't realize about the story about the swastika on the top of that building. And so we got pictures of all that and the story that goes with it.
Would you like to tell us that?
Okay. The building, the Hamilton building, was built by Mr. Hamilton, who was a oil man here in town in the 30s, if I remember correctly. And he wanted to have some tie in to the Indians that lived in, the American Indians that lived here. And so we found out that there was a good luck symbol that the Indians had, which is a swastika. We call it a swastika now. And so he had it put in on the top floor of the Hamilton building. If you look at it, you have to look up there and look at it and see it, but there are swastikas on the wall. Well, you all probably aren't old enough to realize about World War II, but the German nation was our enemy, and the Nazi party was the ruler of Germany, and their symbol was a swastika. And here was this building in downtown Wichita Falls with a German symbol on top of it. So they covered up the top of the story of the building with plywood that stayed all during World War II, so that the swastikas wouldn't show. And there's some more to the story than that, but that's enough for that. But anyway, we had him take pictures of all of that.
Please tell us the rest of this story.
Well, the plywood was just put up and wasn't painted, and it weathered and come flying off in windstorms and all sorts of things. And they had to get back up there, and I think they replaced it. I think the story that I heard was replaced it 2 or 3 times. And they finally built a wall around it of sorts to keep it down, but they didn't want those swastikas showing. And that stayed there for about 5 years after the war before they took them back off again and cleaned up the building. That was a thing that really caused a lot of heartache in town because of people. The propaganda movies that we saw, for instance, I was in junior high school during World War II and was subject to all those things. My dad was off working in a war plant and I missed him, and promised to God if he'd bring him home. Of course, he was just in Grand Prairie working in a plant, but to me that was all for the war, bring him home. And I'd never do anything to make him upset with me, and I tried not to ever do that. I don't think I did. But we were peppered with propaganda movies about the Germans and about the Japanese. And to this day, I will not buy anything that I know was made or came from Japan or Germany. I just can't do it. German cars? No. Japanese cars? No. Can't do it. Buy American made cars, which it turns out probably made in Canada somewhere. But anyway, that's solved my problem that I can't stand him. So we had a lot of that, and people just didn't like the idea that, that those swastikas were going to be around. And
so your intern photographed those in the project?
Yes, and we've got that building documented. We tried to get as much inside the buildings that we thought was needed. A lot of the buildings were, that we documented, were buildings like the Lilly skyscraper and all of the buildings down around LaSalle Street. The old post office building that's being worked on now, on the corner of 8th and Ohio. A lot of the buildings that have since crumbled and been torn down along Ohio Street. We didn't get the pictures of the old hotel and things that was torn down quite a while before that, along down where the radio building, which is now called the Texas Building, I think it is. We didn't get that. It was torn down before we could get it copied.
And I understand that the photos in this project are going to be made available for the Heritage Society?
Yes, I have three large rings of slides. I have a handwritten, and that's the reason I haven't given them to you now, I have a handwritten about 5 or 6 pages of something about each slide, where it is and what it is and that kind of thing. I don't want to type that because I'm the only one that can read that. And for several years after 1975, after Jimmy made the slides and we put them together in this program, I did programs around town under the name of the Heritage Society that here, and I'd show a detail. The slides are arranged so that the detail is the first picture of each building. And we'd show that, and then we'd go get further and further away from the building until somebody could tell us what building it was. And I did about 50 of those programs around town in the two years after 75. Those will become yours. I have since copied them onto a DVD, and I'll go ahead and give you a DVD if anybody wants them right now. But I want you to have the slides, because that's the original part. That's something that none of my boys and girls, my grandchildren, wouldn't be interested in, because they haven't grown up here. Mine lived off somewhere. My wife says, why do our kids have to live way off in Tulsa and Colorado Springs? I said, because we live in Wichita Falls, not Bonham and Lubbock, So at any rate, they wouldn't, that's not anything that would interest them, but it will become property of the Heritage Society.
Do you have any final thoughts or comments that you'd like to tell us about, not so much the Kell family, though we appreciate that detail of meeting Willie May, the Kell House Museum, or the Heritage Society? Any final things you'd like to tell us?
Well, the Heritage Society is better, and I use that word in the kindest sense, it's better than I ever thought it would be. It's doing things that I never dreamed it would be able to do. The hotel project was wonderful, and it really needed to be. That was a building that we also have documented in this, and it's a little bit different story than a lot of people think it is, or at least one story we found out. So we have some of those around, but the Heritage Society is the place that we need that to done. Now there are a lot of other good things in town that have happened since then. The North Texas History Museum is wonderful and works as a hand in hand with the Heritage Society, and I'm very pleased about that too. That's one of the finest little museums I've ever seen. But the Kell House was the first major project that we wanted to do that I had anything to do with, and I don't go to the board meeting now because the board meets on the same day as my Lions Club does, and that's every day, and I need to be there, and the Heritage Society doesn't need me anymore, and they are doing great, better than anybody ever dreamed it would. I'm so proud of everybody in it. And occasionally I get to go to a board meeting and I think back of the 6 of us that used to meet in my office and out on old Jasper Highway, and and how we used to plan and think about what we could do, and it far exceeds anything we ever dreamed of.
Thank you.
I don't even know where all these people are now that are, some of them are still here in town, I see occasionally. Nelma Estes and Lana McDonald still around, I know, or were, and I haven't seen them lately, but they're here, I understand. Robin King left and lives in Kansas or somewhere now. But Robin was a big help in all of this and was a great, great member. Ken Hendrickson, of course, is still here. And we every now and then we meet accidentally and we talk about how something that we had something to do with is so much better than we ever dreamed it would be. We, you know, we thought of it at the time, but they would have thought we'd been planning too much. So that's a great part. The Kells, of course, were all gone when I moved here, except Willie Mae. And she was a gracious lady. She was very old when I met her, and stayed pretty much in the upper room, the upper bedroom of her house up there. But Mr. O'Donohoe, who has since gone, was still alive and going, and was a big help to us and at the starting of the Heritage Society.
Well, that would be Jack O'Donohoe.
Yeah.
He's the son of Carrie Kell O'Donohoe.
Mm-hmm.
And that would have been Willie Mae's nephew.
Okay, I couldn't remember exactly what he was. I knew it was close kin. It was enough that she trusted him, and he trusted us, and he thought that he was all for the Kell House Museum, and I think you all are to be commended for what you've done with it, and I'm very happy with what's happened to the Heritage Society.
Thank you, Charles Harper. We appreciate your time for this.
Well, you're welcome.